So, hello everyone. My session is live now. So if somebody's there, then feel free to write something in the chat so I know that you are there too. That would be really cool, would help me very much. So yeah, I'm waiting for your chat messages to arrive. Hope everything is fine. If you experience something, that something should be wrong with the setup or so, then please also let me know in the chat. I try to have an eye on the chat. And also, if you have any questions, then feel free to ask them in the Q&A tab. And I will try to answer those questions at the end of this talk. Now, let me turn on my screen sharing here. Need this screen. All right, very cool. So first of all, hi and good morning or whatever it is where you are. My name is Christian Liebl. I'm from Germany, and the next talk is about Project Fugu, or how you can superpower your progressive web apps. Before we start, I'd like to quickly introduce myself. My name is Christian Liebl, and I'm a participant of the W3C Web Apps Working Group, and also participant of the MVP program, the Microsoft Expert program, and the Google Expert program, the GDE program. My personal focus topics are Angular, the single page application framework by Google, and PWAs. And if you want to see these slides here again later on, then feel free to open this website here where you can find the PDF of this presentation. If you want to get in touch with me, feel free to use my Twitter handle or to find me on Twitter. Christian Liebl, one word, is the Twitter handle. And if you want to write me an email, that's the email address. And also, if you have any questions, as I already said, then please feel free to use the Q&A tab. And I will answer those questions at the end of this presentation. All right, cool. So let's start. The topic that I want to talk about today is Project Fugu, progressive web apps, and how to superpower them. So first of all, we should clarify what progressive web apps are. Progressive web apps are a web-based application model, and I'm sure most of you are familiar with it. You just navigate to a website, then click the install button in the address bar, and then the application is installed to your disk or to your computer. And when you run it from there, it opens instantly because you can have an offline copy of this application, so you don't necessarily need to go back to the server again. And everything, just works. And all of this is achieved by or with the use of two technologies. The first is the so-called web application manifest. That one defines the appearance and the behavior of the installed application on your computer. And the service worker is in charge of keeping your web application offline. Now, progressive web apps are very cool, and they work in all major browsers for several years now. However, there still were some differences between what native applications could do and what web applications can do. So first of all, what are web applications capable of? As we've just heard, they can run offline. On all browsers except Safari, they can also send push messages to the user. And finally, they also have webcam and microphone access, geolocation access, and so on and so on. So there's a lot of functionality that already works in the web. However, there's also lots of functionality that does not work on the web. For example, until now, at least in most browsers, you can't access the file system directly. You can also not access contents, you could also not access the local fonts table and list the fonts that the user has installed. Now, these three features are something that web developers and app developers desperately need, because you want to access the file system in a certain way, or you want to access the contents of the clipboard, or if you're a Photoshop web app, for example, you of course need to fetch the list of all installed native fonts. So this is the so-called web app gap. There's a gap between what native apps can do and what web apps can do, and we want to close them. And yeah, to be more precise, Project Fugu wants to close them. Fugu is Japanese and means blowfish, as you can see it here, and is also the name of a famous Japanese dish. Fugu is also the flesh of the fugu that we can see here, and tasting it is a very special experience because it makes your tongue feel a bit dizzy because this fish that you can see here is poisonous. And yeah, basically it's a very cool experience, yeah, so that your tongue is a bit different than what you otherwise feel when you eat something. However, it's also hazardous because if the meal is prepared in the wrong way, it can be very dangerous for you. And basically, it's the same for those web interfaces that we've just seen. File system access is very nice to have for application developers, but in the wrong hands, for example, those advertisements, yeah, or other pushy applications, you don't want them to basically do anything on your system. So that's, of course, a problem. And that's the thing about Project Fugu. Interesting APIs for application developers, but yes, we need to be aware of the potential threats that those interfaces may introduce and solve them in a certain way. For example, the Japanese people, they introduced training and licensing, so to say, so only licensed restaurants can offer Fugu, and they need to make sure that the Fugu is a safe experience for you. Project Fugu is a cross-vendor initiative, so it's more than one company or more than one browser vendor, so to say. The first one is Google, the second one is Intel, and the third one is Microsoft. And I'm pretty sure you know all of those three companies. I think Google makes sense, right? So they have Google Docs or Google Workspace and so on. They have web-based applications. And of course, they want that their applications can be very powerful. And that's why we need modern web APIs for that. Also, they publish Google Chrome. Microsoft, I think, is also quite clear. They have, for example, Office in the web, Microsoft 365, the former Office 365. And they also want a powerful platform where their applications can run. Also, they are the vendors of Microsoft Edge. And in the middle, we see Intel. Intel is maybe looks a bit odd between the other two companies, but it makes absolute sense. Intel has seen their telemetry data that the users spend more than 50% of the time in the browser. So the browser is the number one app on the Intel platform. And so they also want to make sure that the number one application runs as best as it can. Yeah, and all of these three companies share one mission. They want to bring the web back API by API. Now, let's have a look at the APIs that Project Fugu wants to introduce. And here is the so-called Fugu API tracker. The Fugu API tracker shows the list of all Fugu APIs that those three companies want to ship. Also, it's not only those three companies, there are also others involved, for example, Samsung Internet, which is also based on the Chromium engine, and others, even individual persons. Yeah, and here in this list, we can see all the APIs that Project Fugu is about. And I want to show you this list here in the browser. So it's Fugu API Tracker. Here it is. All right. And what we can see here on this website is all the APIs that Project Fugu is about. And we start with the APIs that have already shipped. Here we can see the Chromium version. So Chromium 91 is the current version. And we can see there's a whole bunch of APIs that already shipped in a Chromium version. That means Google Chrome, Microsoft Edge, Opera, Brave, Samsung Internet, and so on and so forth. If those vendors decide to ship a certain API, they can also decide against it. And here, for example, we can see an API to access the Bluetooth functionality of your device, the USB interface, the badging API, screen wake lock API, app shortcuts, file system access, and so on and so forth. And this looks pretty impressive already. if you ask me. But yeah, well, if you think that and have a look at the Origin trial, developer trial, and the other APIs that they intend to introduce. For example, here's the handwriting recognition API. You can draw handwritten text on a canvas and then let the device recognize the contents of that. Here we can see the local font access API that will give us access to the local fonts table, and so on and so forth. So the list is basically is almost endless, right? So as you can see here, the shipped APIs are not even 20%, I would say. Yeah, probably 20% of the APIs that Project Fugu is about. So there's a huge backlog of APIs that could ship in Chromium browsers in the future. And they want to close the gap between web and native. Okay. Yeah. So the question is, how does such an API look? Let's say we want to here it is. Come on. Just wait for my slide to change. Here it is. Let's say we want to use the Web Share API. The Web Share API is pretty cool. What it does is it allows you to call or to open the native share dialog, which is provided by your operating system, and to pass data from your application to another one. So here's the code that you need to call in order to show this native share sheet. And now, as you know from the web, there's always exactly one API or exactly one method to call. There's not different methods based on the operating system that you are on. So there's no navigator.open Windows share dialog and no macOS share dialog. But the idea is always that the web is the platform and there's exactly one method to call. And as long as we have it, we can call it, and the browser will take care of calling the actual relevant APIs from the operating system in the background. So if you call navigator.share in order to share this URL, example.com, with another application, your browser will now get this, will now notice this call. It's supported by all major browsers. And the cool thing is that the browser knows for which application it is built for. So during compile time of the browser, this JavaScript API is in the code behind, so to say, wired to the actual native API. So for example, if you call navigator share on Firefox, on Android, then the share intent will be used in the background. If you call navigator.share on Chrome, on Windows, we call the data transfer manager of Windows. And if we are using Safari and call navigator.share there, we will use the NS sharing service picker in behind. As I just said, not all browsers support all interfaces. I also need to correct me there. I think Firefox does not support it yet. So we need to check if an actual API is supported on a target platform. So in order to do so, we use the principle called progressive enhancement. This is really simple. Here, to fulfill this principle, we just have a look at, or we just check if a certain method exists. Here, this if statement checks if we have a share property on navigator. And if it is there, then we assume that we have the share method and the web share API enabled in this browser. So we can call navigator.share. And here, the sample pass a text to it. If this method does not exist, then we can make use of a fallback method. That means we can use a different approach, for example, open a mail to link to bring the mail application up so that the user can still perform this basic task, which was to share the content with another person. If there's no fallback available, you can also disable or hide the functionality in your application. Now, I want to show you some APIs of Project Fugu that this initiative introduced. Let's start with the badging API. Badging API is pretty cool. What the badging API wants to bring us is the following. It wants to communicate updates without distracting the user. Now, in contrast to push notifications, where you always get this notification banner, which is distracting sometimes, there's a second way of informing the user about unread messages or notifications or whatever. Typically, here we see an iOS screenshot. They are placed on the app's badge, for example. Now, the idea of the badging API is that you can do that too. And if you add your PWA to the home screen or to the taskbar, to the dock of your system, that you can also communicate updates with the help of this badge. The appearance, of course, varies from platform to platform, but the idea is typically always to show a number badge at the applications icon. Now, the methods to do so are pretty simple. They are called navigator.setAppBadge. Then you pass the number to it, and you can also clear the badge again by saying navigator.clearAppBadge, and then the badge will be removed again. Now, that's a very simple and cool API. I really like it. It's, I think, supported on Chromium-based browsers on Windows and Mac. It's not supported on Android because they use a different mechanism. They show the number of unread notifications at the app badge, so it doesn't apply here. And again, if it's supported on the system, you can call setAppBadge, and if it isn't, you should avoid to call this API. The next thing is the so-called shortcuts. It's not really an API. Let's call it just shortcuts. What shortcuts are, they provide a secondary entry point for your application. And I'm sure you know this principle. If you long press an icon on the home screen, for example, you can there show additional menu entries to open your application again. And also, this concept can be found on desktop operating systems. If you right-click a taskbar entry on Windows, then there will open a jump list where you can also find additional entry points to your application. You also know it from iOS. If you long press it there, we can see additional actions there too. And here on the right-hand screen, you can see how that looks. So if you long press the Twitter icon, you can then, for example, directly compose in your tweet or explore the trends, read your notifications, and send a direct message. The cool thing here is that this example that you can see here is actually a PWA, the Twitter PWA, making use of the shortcuts. Here's an example of how that looks. So what you need to do as a developer to add shortcuts to your application is to include the shortcuts section in your web app manifest. There's a shortcuts property, and that contains an array. And this array contains different shortcut entries with a certain name or short name with a URL and icons that you add there. And if you do that for your application, you then get this list here. And you can offer your user to directly access some functionality directly from their home screen or jump list or whatever. All right, next API, that's the screen wake lock API. That's also a very cool thing, and I'm sure you all know the problem. Because if you are cooking something and you want to read a recipe, right, on your mobile phone or on your tablet, for example, there's a problem. And the problem is the auto lock of your device, right? So typically it turns off somewhere between after 1 minute not using it or after 5 minutes or so, and then it turns off. And then you have dirty hands from cooking and you want to unlock your phone again. This is not so cool. So we were looking for a solution here. And the solution is the Screen Wake Lock API. This is also very cool. What it does is it tries to prevent your device from turning off for certain situations. For example, when you're watching a movie, well, typically that's the video element already suppresses a standby mode, but while cooking or for games and so on, you may want to disable the standby mode there. So the Screen Wake Lock API allows you to do precisely that. And here's how the API looks. We have, again, the principle of progressive enhancement. We need to see if there's the wake lock property in Navigator. If we have it, then we can call navigator.wakelock.request. Currently, only screen is supported. It could be that you can also let the screen disable, but keep the CPU on in the future. So for now, only screen is supported, and then you have a screen lock. This screen wake lock is automatically returned if you switch the tab, for example. If you go to another tab, then the wake lock will be automatically returned. Again, the Fugu principle, right? Because this could be misused by advertisers that don't play so nicely. That's a Fugu there again. Try to make sure that we can experience those APIs in a safe manner. Okay, the next, now there's more APIs that I want to show you, but before we do that, I want to show you a very cool demo. And you can also try that demo if you like. So if you want, you can open a new tab. So right now, but don't close this one, please, because otherwise I will be gone. If you want, you can open a new tab and navigate to https://paint.js.org. And what this will do is it will open my Paint remake. What I did is I've rewritten the classic Paint for Windows 95 using JavaScript, TypeScript precisely, and web components and Project Fugu APIs. And the cool thing is that I was able to achieve almost all native functionality that also the original Paint included, with one exception, because we can set a desktop wallpaper. There's no actual API to do that from the web, unfortunately, but I think that's also not the number one priority API that we would need to add to the web as a platform. And I can show you more about this demo application. So I hope that but I can also put it in the chat so you can open it there as well, because I don't know how much offset there is between me talking and you receiving it. So paint.js.org. Send. Okay, there you have it. Right, so let me open it here as well, paint.js.org. Right, takes a bit longer here because I'm screen sharing. This always degrades system performance a bit. Yeah, and first of all, this is a classic standard web application. As you can see here in the toolbox, I didn't implement all tools and actions yet, but at least the most important ones. So for example, you can draw here on this nice canvas. You can use the fill tool to fill certain areas of the screen. So this is Paint as you are used to it, right? And also, this is not very surprising, because you can do that for, I think, a decade now, because the underlying technology here is the canvas element for using or for drawing 2D and 3D visualizations in the web. So that's around for a long, long, long time. Now, what's also possible is that if you use this application on your mobile device, you can also use your finger to draw, and you can also use your pen to draw on the canvas. I'm using pointer events here. Pointer events are an abstract interface to just catch all different input methods that modern devices typically have. So it doesn't matter which input device you are using. This web-based variant of Paint works with basically all operating systems, Windows, macOS, Linux, Chrome OS, Android, iOS. It simply doesn't matter, and also the input method doesn't do. Okay, so again, that's the old stuff, canvas element, nothing surprising there. Let's have a look at the next step. The next step is to install this application. And installing applications is supported on a variety of platforms. For example, on iOS, it's possible on Android. And if you're using Chrome or Edge, on all operating systems that Chrome or Edge run on. Firefox does not support installing applications to the system, and Safari on macOS does not allow to install systems to the operating system, at least yet. All right, I guess I need to reload that site here. Let me see, because I'm missing my install button, which should appear here in the top right corner. I hope you should have that. I hope I didn't break anything because I had a coding session over the weekend. So let's see. Yeah, indeed, we don't get... Okay, interesting. Well, but we can simulate it. That's also possible. So what I will do is... Yeah. What I will do is the following. I will click the more tools and then create shortcut button there. So what I will do is I will fix that afterwards. You are supposed to install this right from the address bar, but now we can, for now we can just simulate it. It looks like I broke something during my code session over the weekend. So right, here's the paint shortcut. We want to open it as a window. Typically, you don't need to click this. And then you can click the create button. What happens now is that the tab will close and automatically, and this should be faster on your side, now the application is opening in a standalone window. Now, this is an own window. You can also see that it has received an own dock entry, so we can even move that to the dock to be permanently there. And it will also appear here in the list of open programs. So this is now treated as an operating system level program, so to say. However, it's still Chrome, which is here working in the background, which is powering this entire application. And everything continues to work, so we can draw on this interface here. Yeah, still great, still as great as before. Also, what you can see is that we are able to define an icon, that we can define the color of the window bar. Here, I went for the Windows 95 dark blue to nicely blend in with the rest of the application. And again, on which operating system you do this, it doesn't matter. It works on all operating systems, at least, if I didn't break it. I can show you a different demo that you can see how it's supposed to look like. So here in the top right corner, yeah, perfect. There you can see an install button, and you should get that on the paint install button, and then you can directly install it to your system. This is how the dialog looks. Okay, perfect. So now we install this application here. Also, again, it's offline capable, so I do not need to connect to the internet in order to open the app. Let me close it and open it from the shortcut again. We should see that the window directly opens, the application is directly there. We do not need to connect to a server or something. It's instantly there, it's super fast. And even though my system performance is degraded right now because of the screen sharing, it should be there instantly for you on your system. Okay, good. Now, that's not all, of course. Now we want to talk about further Fugu APIs and the Paint application already implements them. So, for example, there's the async clipboard API. That's pretty cool. What you can do here is you can access the clipboard contents. For example, you can write data to it, plain text or PNG, graphics, HTML, and so on. And you can also paste content from the native clipboard. Writing to the clipboard currently does not require any consent. That's so you don't need to give permission. Writing always works, so to speak. And as reading from the clipboard can be a problem because of privacy, the user will permission at least once. So currently in Chrome, you need to give permission once. Safari wants your permission always. So you always need to confirm that the web application may read from the clipboard. Now, let's see how that looks in our Paint application. Oh, I need to open it again. Here it is. Okay, perfect. Here it is. Great. Yeah. And now we can draw something. So we are currently at Dev Days Europe. So let's just say Dev Days. Okay, excellent. Now what you can do is you can use a select tool and select our great drawing that we just did. Let's see. Okay. And now I should be able to cut it out. Okay, perfect. And now it's gone. What I can do now is I can open the preview app of macOS. Preview is basically the paint, so to say, of macOS. What we can do here is we can create a new document from the clipboard. And if I click that one, here a preview window will show up. And this now contains our nice drawing from the Paint application. And now preview also allows me to draw here. So let's draw. Oops, okay. Yeah, I should select a draw tool first. Let's draw a circle here, for example. Now I can select everything here, copy it. I hope I, oh no, it's just a select tool. Select all, copy, and bring it back to our Paint application by saying edit, paste. And now when you do that for the first time, you need to consent. And if you did already give your permission, then yeah, it will just work. And I did already give permission to this website, so it will continue to work here. So this is fine. Here we can see the contents from our native application. So that's for the clipboard. Just works perfectly. Okay, now I try to close this document here. You can see everything is a bit slow here on my end. Delete. All right. The next cool thing is the so-called File System Access API. Now, currently, websites do have some sort of access to the file system right now. Because what you can do currently is you can use the input type file control to get access to a file from the local file system. And what you can also do is you can use the A anchor and then download attribute to directly send a dynamically created binary large object, for example, to the downloads folder. So you can open files from the file system using that input file picker, and you can save it at least to the downloads folder. However, that's not really sufficient. For example, it's not sufficient for the Paint clone because the traditional workflow there is that you start with a new document, save it, and you can decide where it should be saved to. So it should not only go directly to the downloads folder, but you want to select to which folder you want to save it. Also, if you open a file using input type file and you modify it, you want to overwrite the original file and not save a copy to a completely different location. So that's where File System Access API comes into play. It wants to solve exactly this traditional productivity app workflow. And of course, Paint is a very nice example for that traditional productivity app. Let's have a look at the API. I think you already know the concept. A progressive enhancement first, File System Access is only supported by Chromium-based browsers right now. So you need to check if the show open file picker method is there. If it is, you can choose to show an open file picker and the user can select a file from it. If they do so, you get a handle to that file and then you can do something with it. And if this method does not exist, you can use that fallback API input type file, or you can disable the functionality in your application. Again, as we already have some sort of fallback mechanism in the web, you can use the Paint application on basically any platform because they support either a File System Access API or at least the fallback typically. What you can also do is you can specify the types of files that you want to consume. For example, here with this type array, you can say, hey, I only want to read PNG files. And if you would want to consume more than one file, you can also do so by specifying the multiple property. You can open files, but you can also get handles through directories. That works as well if you are working on a certain directory. And basically this it's really cool because this API unblocks a lot of productivity apps. For example, VS Code, which is already web-based, could now perfectly run in the web because you could simply open a folder and then work on this very folder without needing without having to install the Electron client. And again, this is also supported by the Paint application here. So we can save this file to the disk by using the save function. Then the save handler should appear. Here it is. Let's call it Untitled 2. I want to save it to the desktop. And let me also bring my desktop up so that we can see directly what happens. Here it is, click save. All right, as you can see here at the top, it also now got access to the name that I selected, which was Untitled 2. And you can see that it also directly appeared here in the file system. And now if I say want to draw something there, and I would like to create a new drawing, it warns me, hey, wait, there's changes that you did to this file. Do you want to save them? Then we can hit yes. It will now go to the new document. And if we have a look here at our drawing, we can see the little X that I just drew on the canvas. And also, it supports the open method. So you could also open just the open menu entry. You can also drag and drop the file here within that component, and then it loads it again. So basically all the productivity app workflow that you are familiar with is now possible to implement in the web. All right, now the last API that I want to talk about is the file system handling API. That's also super cool because what allows that API is that you can register your PWA as a handler for a certain file extension. This requires installing the application first. So you need to basically add your app to the home screen as I did before. And then you declare support for certain file extensions in the web application manifest for one. And the other part, you need to add imperative code to your application logic in order to support this functionality. So here's how the first part looks. That's the extension to the manifest. It's called file handlers, not a part of the official specification of the web app manifest. So that's a rather unofficial thing. You need to specify an action there. So that's the window that is then opened. And you can specify the MIME types or media types and the file extensions that you want to register this PWA for. That's now for the logic part. Your application will be started, and then you can check if there's you can find the contents in the so-called launch queue. Again, progressive enhancement. Not all browsers have the launch queue right now, so you need to check if there is the launch queue property on the global window object, and if there is, you can call this consumer method, and there you will get access to the files that your application was opened with. Now, the thing is, this requires installation, so I'm not sure if my hack of installing the shortcut did the exact same thing. So we need to find out. Let me right-click this file here and go to open with. Yes, but it looks quite good because as we can see here, the paint application was registered for PNG files. So if I click that now, my paint application should come up again. Okay, yeah, it was already open, so I will close it so we can see it again. Okay, let me see. Now that's the Fugu again. So for the first time you do this, you need to confirm that. But I would like to show it to you again, so I cancel it for now. I hope that doesn't mean a rejection. So now again, we want to open the exact same application by saying open with paint. Now you can see that the icon in the dock starts to jump up and down. So it's opened. Now the window should come up. And again, on your side, it should be much faster than it is for me. So that's terribly slow. Yeah, perfect. So for the first time you do this, you need to give your permission, which I do here. And then your file from the file system opens again. Really nice. Okay, now what does this mean for us as web developers or as application developers? Where is the web heading to? In my opinion, the web is heading to more PWAs. And I think, or why do I think this? Because we already see tendencies of that happening. For example, VS Code, I already mentioned that, is a IDE which is written in or with the help of web technology. So VS Code is just a web app executed by an Electron container, and we currently do need this container because it does not only support accessing the file system, but also, for example, displaying the terminal. So that's maybe a blocker why VS Code maybe cannot do a 100% shift to the web, at least yet. And also, yeah, native applications such as PowerPoint, we can now replicate their entire workflow, opening files, saving files, overwriting them, and so on, in the browser. So basically, also applications like this could be written for the browser. And as you know, with Office 365, this has already happened. So those web clients will get ever more powerful. So with every new release of Chromium-based browsers, new powerful Fugu APIs ship with them. We've seen that in the Fugu API tracker. So the goal for this year is to refine those APIs. So there are new APIs for the desktop, but there's also a strong focus on improving the APIs that are already there. So yeah, there's, I think the exciting APIs we have already seen, so that is File System Access and the Clipboard Access API. As we've also seen, there's a whole bunch of other APIs that we can expect in the web. So yeah, there will be more to talk about in the future. Some APIs have also already made their way into other browsers. So it's not only the case that only Chromium-based browsers support those APIs. For example, Safari was the first browser to adopt WebShare API on the desktop. And they also implemented the Context Picker, another Fugu API, with the release of iOS 15, I believe. The Fugu process makes sure that those cool capabilities are implemented in a secure and privacy-preserving manner. So what we should do as application developers is to make the web a more capable platform and write better web applications. So now I would have time for your questions. Currently, I don't see any questions in the Q&A tab, but feel free to ask them, or feel free to ask them in the chat. So I keep, I've kept an eye on that already, but I also didn't see a question there yet. So feel free to use the opportunity if you like. Otherwise, again, I'm happy to follow up with you. If you have any questions, then feel free to send me a tweet or an email, and I'll be happy to get back to them. So I don't see any questions or new chat messages now. So I assume that there are none. So then I would like to thank you for your kind attention. Thanks for joining this morning. And I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference. And yeah, maybe we can see each other one day in person soon, or in person again. At least I'm looking forward to that. So yeah, enjoy the rest of the conference, enjoy your day, and see you soon. Thank you and goodbye. Oh, Marcin, there is a question. Ooh, let me see. Do you have any resources for a list of suitable fallbacks to Fugu APIs? So no list, actually. What I can recommend is to look at the documentation of those APIs in WebDev. WebDev is a portal by Google, and all Fugu APIs are documented there. At least the published APIs are documented there, and typically those and those articles typically they also cover the fallbacks, at least where that makes sense. Let me see, where do we have a fallback where it would make sense? We have one, let's say the file system access API. Let's see, it could be that one. Yeah, so basically again, no exact list, but you could check up the documentation, and typically they mention the fallbacks that you can use if an API is not available. And if I'm not wrong, I guess, or I hope, that the input type file, here it is, and the download method are documented there, right? So there you can see a polyfill if it is available, or at least there's a fallback solution that's available. And also, at least here in this case, the Google Chrome team has provided an experiment, the so-called Browser FS Access NPM package that uses a file system access API when it is available, and otherwise directly falls back to those fallback mechanisms here. So, not quite sure how to pronounce the name. Jose, Joe's, I'm not sure. Hope that answers your question. So no exact list, but you can find the fallback solutions if they exist in the documentation on WebDev. All right, perfect. So then that looks like it was the only question. So, and also thank you for your positive feedback, comments. That's always nice to hear. Yeah, so enjoy the rest of your day. And again, hope to see you soon. Bye.